In the heart of the Mojave, scientists are working to save a species from extinction, the Amargosa Vole.
So, Patrick, orient me. Where exactly am I right now?
We are in the Pahrump Valley. It's a large valley right on the state line with Nevada and California.
I'm exploring the Vole's desert habitat with Patrick Donnelly, the executive director of the Amargosa Conservancy.
Now, tell me about the Vole. How many are there, and do they only live in this area?
The Vole is endemic to Tecopa Marsh. So Tecopa Marsh is about 4 or 5 square mile area where there's a number of springs, and these springs feed bulrush habitat, which is where the voles live. There's probably only 50 to 150 of these voles left in the wild. So it's a critically endangered species. It's actually been called the most endangered mammal in North America.
In a world of extinction, efforts to save a tiny mouse-like animal represent no small feat.
For those who don't know, what is a vole?
Well, many people, when they think of a vole, think of a pest in their front yard eating up their grass. And sure enough, it is a similar creature, but the Amargosa vole is a specific species that's adapted to bulrush habitat in marshes. It's a small mammal. It's about 5 inches long, 2 inches tall, and weighs just a couple of grams.
And why do we care about the vole?
Well, the vole is really an indicator of the health of our wetland ecosystems. As the vole goes, so our water goes.
Water preservation in the Pahrump Valley is the top priority for the Amargosa Conservancy, a nonprofit organization dedicated to protecting the Amargosa River and its wildlife.
So when I look at this, I see large stretches of beautiful desert, but you see water issues. Tell me what you see.
We are in the middle of a flow zone. Water is flowing from Mount Charleston underneath us and across that mountain range out there to the Amargosa River. Historically, there's been much more snow on top of Mount Charleston, but as that water melts, it eventually percolates through this aquifer and to the Amargosa River. So we're really in a very special hydrological place right now.
And how far is the river from here?
It's about 70 miles from the summit of Mount Charleston to the bottom of the Amargosa River.
That's kind of amazing, isn't it?
It really is. It's remarkable.
So if things don't go well up there on Mount Charleston, the vole way down there suffers, and then everybody suffers.
That's right. And there's a combination of factors in the water in this valley. Mount Charleston snowpack is one of them, and groundwater pumping in the Pahrump Valley is another. The more water we withdraw from this aquifer for housing and farming and utility scale solar, the less of that water is going to make it through to the Amargosa River.
Let's get further down the road. There's more to see.
All right, let's go.
The vole serves as an environmental indicator for the health of this entire ecosystem and of the natural resources available to the whole community.
So, this is an important spot for the vole, huh?
Absolutely. This is ground zero for vole conservation. We are doing this reintroduction here, and we really think it's the last best hope for the Amargosa vole. This is our chance to get them to reclaim former habitat and to repopulate this area.
UC Davis conducts a breeding program that strives to raise the vole population. Researchers have 80 baby voles ready to be introduced to their habitat.
This is a soft release cage.
Okay.
This is where we're going to release the voles in a few weeks here. So this cage provides protection from predators and other influences while they become acclimated to the marsh habitat.
And this will be their introduction into actual nature, yeah?
Yeah, so they're in what's called a mesocosm right now in Davis, where it's a simulated bulrush habitat. So they're already becoming acclimated to the idea of reeds and marshy areas.
You got more to show me?
Absolutely. Let's go check out the heart of the vole habitat.
Yeah, let's go.
Conservationists hope that the introduction of these captive voles will save the species. Without drastic improvements, the Amargosa vole has a 99% chance of being extinct in the next 5 years.
This is perfect bulrush habitat. It's isolated. It has a steady stream of water coming from the hot springs. Voles thrive in a habitat like this.
Bulrush is extremely important. This is not to be considered your average weed.
No, definitely not. Bulrush is the best habitat for the vole. And really, in ecological terms, it's what's known as an obligate relationship. The vole has to have bulrush to exist. The vole eats bulrush, it nests in bulrush, and it crawls around in bulrush. We actually have a good example of a tunnel here. This is a vole tunnel.
Oh, it's bigger than I thought.
It goes way back into the bulrush, and that is where the vole gets around. It gets to its food.
Voles are nocturnal creatures, which makes it difficult to catch a glimpse of them in daylight, although we can still identify clues of their existence and behaviors throughout the bulrush.
This is an example of something a vole has eaten. They eat the succulent tops off the bulrush, and that is how they survive. That's their main food source.
Why can't we just plant this stuff in other places? Because of the water?
Well, water conditions are very important to bulrush's existence, and there are certain types of conditions that it grows in. However, that is our next step. We start reintroducing the voles, they establish themselves in the existing bulrush, and then we plant a bunch more bulrush to expand their habitat. That's the real goal here.
The captive voles are tagged and outfitted with radio transmitters that allow researchers to track their movements and detect survival for up to a year.
Typically, voles live their entire life cycle within a 100-foot radius. So they barely move from one location at all in their whole lives.
So there's a good chance that there's one within 100 feet of right here.
Very likely, yeah. And we will never see him.
That is beautifully frustrating.
Well, I think it actually adds to the mystery of the vole, you know? We do all this work out here day in and day out to try to save this critter. We may never see them except when they come into a trap.
The overall project will likely take years. For Patrick, this effort is a labor of love. Love for this little mammal on the verge of extinction.
What would you do if this doesn't work?
You know, the vole keeps me awake at night. I lay there thinking about saving the vole and what might happen if it does not get saved. It would be just personally devastating to lose this animal. And it would really be an indicator that we're losing something greater in this ecosystem. We're losing our water. And since that is the critical element that makes the Amargosa such a special place, failure is not an option.
Well, I can't imagine the vole having a better advocate than you, and that's what allows me to sleep at night. So thank you for all that you do.
Well, thank you for coming out here. We appreciate it.
The vole may be a small animal, but it's got a great big impact. And when a lot of people think of Nevada, they think of really rugged features, but it certainly has its delicate parts too. It's just a real good thing that there's people who care about those delicate parts as well.